of exhibit in which a burning or flaming cross is simulated with the intention of intimidating any person. And that's key, the intention. We talked about intention, intent, and we talked about motive. This is one of those specific intent crimes where you don't just put a cross in someone's yard because you want to see it burn. It becomes a crime if you intend for it to intimidate someone. And again, how do we get to that intent? There's not going to be a individual that intent, but you'll see some context of the event, what was meant by burning that cross. Most of the Klan laws that were passed in the 1950s were misdemeanor. They made misdemeanor crimes of those activities. There were a few, like burning a cross, that was a felony and is a felony. And so it looks something like this on our felony sentencing chart. Most of the judges in North Carolina either have this committed to memory or they carry this chart at their fingertips. We use it all the time. And this is exactly what I am looking at when I am on the bench. To orient you, a Class A felony is the most serious felony we have, a first-degree murder. It's at the top of the chart. And a Class H is towards the bottom. An I is the lowest level felony in North Carolina. And so this cross burning would be a Class H. And it moves from left to right based upon a person's prior record. So you'll see at the top, Roman numeral 1 with 0 to 1 point. That means somebody who doesn't have or has a very minimal prior record, all the way over to a prior record level 6. And so as a Class H felony, the shaded part in the middle is what we call the presumptive range. That's the average of what people get for a Class H felony. And that's what a cross burning is in North Carolina. Now, as I mentioned, fast forward, we began to see a wave of laws come into place that had to do with the motivation behind the crime. And one of those laws is ethnic intimidation. It's still on our books today. And motive is a necessary element of that particular crime. So you heard me say at the very beginning, I generally tell juries they don't have to worry about motive. It's instructive, but mostly immaterial. For ethnic intimidation, though, it's an element of the crime. And so the prosecution has to prove that someone was motivated to do something based upon, in this particular case, race, color, religion, nationality, or country of origin. And what this does is elevate that crime up to some higher level offense than what it ordinarily would be. Ethnic intimidation involves an assault, and an assault on an ordinary day is a Class 2 misdemeanor. If I just walk up and punch somebody without doing much harm to them, excuse me, that's a Class 2 misdemeanor. But if I do it with ethnic intimidation because of their race, color, national origin, that elevates up to a Class 1 misdemeanor. Also, damage to property is a Class 2, just like an assault. But if I do it with the motive of ethnic intimidation, it will elevate it also to a Class 1 misdemeanor. And so here's what the misdemeanor chart looks like, much like the felony chart I just showed you. An assault or an injury to property is normally a Class 2, but if you do it with ethnic intimidation, that elevates it up to a Class 1. So these are in days. Somebody in a Class 2 would normally get 30 days with no prior conviction. Now it becomes a 45-day offense because of ethnic intimidation. And just to clarify, the previous chart, the felony chart, was done in months. The misdemeanor chart is done in days. And then there are penalty enhancements. So usually on a charge enhancement, the charging officer or prosecutor is the one who's going to decide, am I going to charge ethnic intimidation? Am I going to add that layer of proof onto my requirement as a prosecutor? But for a penalty enhancement, the judge makes that determination. There'll be some offer of proof by the prosecutor usually, but the judge will decide whether to apply that penalty enhancement. And so here's an example of a penalty enhancement statute, which basically tracks the earlier one. If you have done something on the basis of race, color, religion, nationality, or country of origin, then misdemeanors can jump up from a 2 or 3 up to a 1. Maybe even a high-level misdemeanor can jump up to a class H felony. On the felony side, again, the court, the judge, is making a decision about whether to apply that enhancement. And generally what happens is a prosecutor will offer some proof about why it's being done, why the crime has been done. And then the court has got to decide, is there enough proof there for me to make that finding? In this particular, on the felony level, it's number 17, so you'll see where the arrow is. A judge is generally looking down the list and deciding which of those apply, and so it may be that 17 applies. And then the judge has to do some weighing, because on the defense side, they have often offered what we call mitigating factors. On the other side, so the prosecution offers aggravating factors to take the crime higher, the defense is offering mitigating factors to take the crime lower, and then the court has to do some balancing. But we are considering what the motive is in that particular circumstance and ultimately making a decision. Now, what you may notice is missing from this language, number 17, and from the earlier slides I showed you, is any reference to gender, sexual orientation, disability, or age. Those right now are not part of what North Carolina's hate crime structure looks like. There were some laws introduced in the late 1990s that would have added gender, sexual orientation, age, disability to that framework, but those laws did not pass. And so as we stand today, those are not part of North Carolina's hate crime structure. You're a lot of I take no position on that. I just interpret the law that's already there. All right, so I was going to use as an example another assault. I told you a simple assault is me just walking up, punching someone without doing much injury to that person. But if I punch them and actually do a fair amount of injury, it could be a felony. Have a felony in North Carolina called assault inflicting serious bodily injury. And so if I put someone in the hospital in a coma, in a permanent state of disability, that is a more serious assault that could be a felony. And it's an F felony. So again, same chart, A down to I, F is a little bit below the midline. And the average, again, is in that shaded area in the middle in terms of months. This is the felony chart, so we're talking about months. But if that aggravating factor applies, it's the same level of offense, it's still an F, but the judge, after doing that balancing, could elevate up into the high level, the aggravated range. So let's look at a prior record level 1. No prior convictions. The average would be 13 to 16 months on the low end. Mm-hmm. But if I apply the aggravating factor of race, national origin, then the person is looking at potentially 16 to 20 on the low end. That's just how the chart works. Now, hate crimes are on the books in most all states around the country, some version of them. Other states may include sexual orientation and the like, but versions of hate crimes are on the books all over the country. And states are now required to report to the FBI what hate crimes are being committed in their state so that nationally we can track how bad of a problem it is. And the FBI collects information about hate crimes. You'll see that race and ethnicity is the dominant hate crime. These are from all around the country, followed by religion and then sexual orientation. As I mentioned, we don't have a sexual orientation protected class in North Carolina, but there are other places, followed by gender and gender identity, disability, and gender. Now I wanted to walk through some cases, some real life cases of things that have happened not so far from home. So this is a case, State versus Choppy, that happened in 1997. 7, just up the mountain in Asheville, North Carolina. Mr. Chapman is pictured in that photograph, and he was convicted of 4 counts of attempted first-degree murder. He and a friend, after a night of partying and cavorting around Asheville, went on a bit of a shooting spree. They killed 3 Navy officers who were up on the Blue Ridge Parkway, and then they killed a gentleman walking down the street before driving home and then on their way home shooting a gentleman on the freeway. And later on, Mr. Choppy was, of course, charged and tried, and his co-defendant testified against him that after the events had happened, Mr. Choppy was joking about the fact that he'd shot this black man. And the defendant mimicked how the man looked as he was walking down the street. And you'll see what Mr. Choppy said about that man who was walking down the street. Now, Mr. Choppy at trial said he was intoxicated, he was drunk, he didn't have any specific recall about that evening and what he may have said or not said. But Mr. Choppy's girlfriend also testified against him. I found that to be an interesting twist. Because the night of the shooting, I said Mr. Choppy was cavorting around, and he was not with his girlfriend that particular evening. So his girlfriend had something to say about the events as well. She testified against him. And she wasn't with them when the shootings happened, but she talked about some of the bragging he did after the fact. And both her testimony and the co-defendant's testimony contributed to his conviction. And the Court of Appeals, Mr. Choppy appealed his conviction, but the Court of Appeals said that his motivation for those attacks was not determinative. It wasn't the deciding factor about why he killed those particular individuals. The other individuals, the 3 Navy sailors, the driver, those were not minorities. But for the one that he did kill walking down the street, the court did say that particular individual he had singled out because he was black. There was some testimony from the co-defendant that Mr. Choppy said, "There's a nigga, turn around, let's get it." And so, as you'll see, the court applied that aggravating factor. They went from the middle range, the presumptive range, up into the aggravated range for purposes of sentencing Mr. Choppy, and he received a sentence of 146 years. Mr. Choppy remains in custody to this day. Next, we have a case out of Winston-Salem, a 1998 case. And this was a black on Hispanic crime. This involved the defendant, Michael Hatcher. Mr. Hatcher was convicted of 2 counts of armed robbery. He and again, a co-defendant, did some activities. They robbed 2 individuals at gunpoint, stole their car and their wallets. Again, at trial, the co-defendant testified against the primary defendant, Michael Hatcher, and indicated that they selected those 2 particular men because they thought Hispanics carried a large sum of cash and would be less likely to report the crime. And so, just like in the earlier case, the court applied the bias aggravated factor and ultimately sentenced Mr. Hatcher to 23 years in prison, and he was paroled just last year. The court said in that particular case, Mr. Hatcher had argued that the court ought to overturn his conviction because he didn't hate those 2 individuals. It was his argument that to apply that aggravating factor meant he needed to hate those 2 individuals that he had robbed. And the court said no, there's no language in the statute to suggest any such limiting requirement that a defendant harbor any animosity toward a race or ethnic group. The statute merely provides that the offense be committed against the victim because of their race. And so they upheld his conviction and the application of that aggravating factor. And then I'll move to State versus David Brown. That's a more recent case in 2018, just up I-85 in Greensboro. Mr. Brown was convicted of assault with a deadly weapon with ethnic animosity. The defendant, Mr. Brown, was a white man, and he fired some shots at another white man, Mr. Peterson. And the dispute apparently had to do with Mr. Peterson's girlfriend, who was Mr. Brown's next door neighbor. The girlfriend, Catherine Richards, was an African-American woman. And the evidence tended to show that Mr. Brown and Ms. Richardson had had a lot of going back and forth as neighbors, arguing over fences and dogs and that sort of thing. But Ms. Richardson had some children, teenage children, and he made some racial remarks towards those children over time. And things just had been building for a while. And on this particular occasion, Mr. Peterson came over to see Ms. Richards, and a dispute erupted. You'll see what language Mr. Brown used towards Mr. Peterson. And ultimately, that sentence was enhanced from an A1 misdemeanor to an H felony. And he was sentenced to, Mr. Brown was sentenced to 6 to 8 months. At that point, he had had enough credit. He had been in jail awaiting his trial, so he was given credit for time served. And this was a case of first impression for the appeals court, because what Mr. Brown was arguing was, because I'm white and I shot at another white man, then ethnic intimidation or ethnic animosity can't apply. I can't be found guilty, I can't have my sentence enhanced when I shoot someone who is of the same race as I am. And the court had never dealt with that question before. But the court ultimately drew some analogies between that particular fact pattern and some Title VII discrimination cases, employment discrimination cases. And so it looked at some situations where white managers had taken action against other white people or black managers against other black people. And so the court said, no, it's not exclusively one race against a different race. And so it upheld Mr. Brown's conviction and the enhancement of his sentence. Now, as I mentioned at the outset, there are two systems. There's a criminal system. We've talked mostly about the criminal system so far. And people think of the criminal system to do with punishment, and in a lot of respects, it does have to do with punishment or jail time. But we also have a civil system, civil justice system, which is about damages. Oftentimes, we are talking about monetary damages on the civil side. How can we compensate somebody for the harm that they have suffered? But does hate have any application on the civil side? It does. Not quite as frequently as you might see it on the criminal side, but it does come up. It can form the basis for some civil causes of action, like discrimination, like defamation, libel, and slander type cases. Heard of those before. There are actions, causes of action for malicious prosecution. You prosecuted me because I'm a black person, and you would not have done that otherwise. Hate comes up in the context of civil law. If you have been found responsible for some sort of discriminatory action, then you cannot have those damages removed in bankruptcy. So when you go through bankruptcy, oftentimes you're trying to have credit removed or creditors removed. You cannot have a judgment on the basis of some discriminatory action removed during your bankruptcy. And it can also enhance your punishment through punitive damages that get added on to any judgment. So we're going to talk some about how this word, this notion of hate, comes up in the criminal, in the civil context. Most often, it comes up in the civil context around discrimination. And discrimination takes a lot of different forms in the civil context, but many people are familiar with the Civil Rights Act of 1964. How many of you were around when the Civil Rights Act of 1964 was passed? So the Civil Rights Act of 1964 prohibited discrimination on the basis of sex, race, color, national origin, and religion. around voter registration, desegregation of schools, the employment context, public accommodations. All of those changes in the law have fallen under the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and how the court interprets the breadth of that statute. And so what the courts have looked at as they are interpreting that statute and its expansion is whether or not states have the power to regulate interstate commerce. And so when you talk about public accommodations, hotels, and where people can stay, often they're staying because they crossed state lines. They've gone to another state and are trying to get a hotel room. And so the courts have said that Congress has the authority to regulate that kind of activity because it crosses state lines. They've also looked at it in terms of equal protection under the law. And so when you think of equal protection, you think of the laws applying to the same to people in North Carolina the same way they would apply to people in South Carolina or Georgia or Florida or anywhere else. And so courts have taken the position that the Civil Rights Act does invoke notions of equal protection and have therefore expanded some of its interpretation. And also the 15th Amendment, voting rights, they have expanded into that particular field as well. There's also another application in the civil side when we think of hate and how we distinguish between people and how we feel about people is the Defense of Marriage Act. That's a more modern act that has come into play and was interpreted more recently in United States versus Windsor. That had to do with the estate of two married women. They had been married in New York, and New York recognized same-sex marriage. And when one of those women ultimately died, an estate tax was applied to her estate, her wealth, at the conclusion of her life. And her estate was trying to get a tax refund. They said that they should be exempt from this estate tax. The surviving spouse of the decedent should be exempt from this estate tax. The Defense of Marriage Act, however, defined marriage and did not include same-sex partners. And so the United States was arguing that this tax ought to apply because this marriage did not qualify as a marriage as it was defined in the DMA. It was a very close call by the United States Supreme Court. They held in a 5-4 decision that the Defense of Marriage Act violated the U.S. Constitution Equal Protection Clause. Because the state's decision to give same-sex couples the right to marry conferred upon them a benefit that was immensely important, and that the government used that class then to do something opposite for people in that class. That then had equal protection implications, and so the court, the U.S. Supreme Court, ultimately struck down that particular statute, the Defense of Marriage Act, that created some distinction between same-sex marriages and opposite-sex marriages. It also comes up, this notion of hate, when we think about freedom of speech, First Amendment, and what people can say or can't say about the people that they like or dislike. As you know, the First Amendment affords some protection to expressive conduct, not just what you say. It's also about what you do. But that protection under the First Amendment is not absolute. It doesn't mean you can do and say anything under the First Amendment. The government does have the power to regulate certain categories of expression consistent with the United States Constitution. And so the First Amendment does allow some restriction on content of speech in a very limited area. Those that have slight social value as a step to the truth, that any benefit that may be derived from them is clearly outweighed by the social interest in order and morality. And in one of these cases, the Supreme Court was taking a look at the freedom of speech as it relates to what we call fighting words. Now, when I was growing up, if you said something about somebody's mama, those were fighting words. But then that means something a little bit different in the context of the law. RAV versus St. Paul's, a 1992 case that arose out of St. Paul, Minnesota. In that particular case, RAV, whose initials we don't know, was cited for violating a St. Paul city ordinance. And that ordinance basically made it unlawful for you to burn a cross in the yard of an African-American family. So that goes back to some earlier talk we had about cross burning in North Carolina, although this is the Minneapolis version, I mean St. Paul version. Now, the Supreme Court in that particular case ultimately struck down that city ordinance. It said even if the expression reached by the ordinance was prescribable as fighting words or fighting conduct, offensive conduct, the ordinance was facially unconstitutional because it prohibited something other than just speech. It was prohibiting a subject of speech, which you cannot do. And so when we think about what people talk about that offends us, and they ought not be able to say that because that offends us, that has First Amendment implications. Because just like you don't like what they say, you also want to be free to say what you want to say. And what the government cannot do is attack people's right to say what they want to say on a subject, a blanket subject prohibition. And so that's what the court viewed this particular ordinance as doing, a blanket prohibition on a particular kind of subject. Now, if it had been a little bit more narrowly tailored, who knows what would have happened? Well, we do know what would have happened, because it was taken up next in Johnson versus Quattlebaum in 2016, a fairly recent case. The Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals did an unpublished opinion. Now, the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals is just a step beneath the Supreme Court. The Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals governs North Carolina and some surrounding states, South Carolina, Virginia, Maryland, and so forth. And this was appealed to the Fourth Circuit. They took a look at a South Carolina law that was prohibiting the use of some obscene language. And in this particular case, Ms. Johnson had called the police out to her house. She was visiting someone in Saluda, South Carolina. And when the police got there, Officer Quattlebaum was the officer that responded, and Ms. Johnson was quite upset about some activities going on in her neighborhood, and so she was using some expletives. And I won't repeat that language. But her language, there was a school just 50 or 60 yards away, and this South Carolina law prohibited the use of unprotected speech or fighting words, which was in hearing distance of a school or a church. And in this particular case, Ms. Johnson was very close to a school. And as she went on her kind of tirade about what was going on, officers ultimately arrested Ms. Johnson. And Ms. Johnson says, wait a minute, I was just exercising my freedom of speech. I ought to have the ability to say what I want to say, when I want to say it, and the court ought not interfere with my ability to do that. And so this is an unpublished opinion. It doesn't have quite as much persuasive value or authoritative value when we are trying to decide what to do in future cases, but it's still instructive. And so the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals in this particular case upheld that statute and said because it was narrowly tailored and it didn't implicate protected speech, that this particular statute in South Carolina was okay, and therefore Ms. Johnson's being cited for violating that particular statute was okay. So with that, I am going to turn it over to Pastor Jones. As I said, he is going to spend some time talking with you about the biblical and spiritual implications of hate, and then at the end, we'll certainly entertain any questions.
Good evening, peace. I want to minds together. But I think we make a rather tactical error when we separate the government from the church in terms of this whole issue. See, I like control, right? when we separate our responsibilities from to government and our commitments to Christ. Repeated the Pledge of Allegiance. What was that we said about under God?
One nation.
Where?
Under God.
One nation, where?
Under God.
We say that, but is that really what's happening in praxis?
No.
Thank you, Judge Archie. As always, it's I don't know why I let you go first. I have to change that committee. I think I need to sort of go first. Very thorough and PowerPoint, and I hope we were listening and watching carefully. And thank you for coming out this afternoon. I know it's been a long day, and it's a beautiful day. And to come and spend this afternoon for an hour, hour and a half with us is tremendous, and we're gratified by it. And I want to thank our Social Justice Committee for what you're doing, and we'll continue to do this, and it's just good to see all of you. I want to spend a little time in the context of this issue of hatred, not only biblically, but some of you know that I like a little history. And so I'm going to delve over and pick at a few possible historical pieces out of a biblical context. Did Abel's family have grounds for a civil suit? Some of you abstain because it's always easy. You're the jury, you have to vote. I want you to think through that. In a pure legal system, did Abel's family have grounds for a legal suit? That's one question. No answer. That's okay. I'm looking for one right now. Second thing I think that's critical before I go further is this whole issue of judges. I hope you listen carefully that with the statutes that we have, at the end of the day, the judge has to determine, and the judge is the one that will say whether you get 30 days or 16 months within that parameter. Am I correct to say that, Judge? More or less, that we expect the judge to be fair in that whole process. But if the judge has issues with gender, religion, or ethnic background, can that play into the decision that the judge will make?
Yes.
The answer is yes. It's been over 40, oh, maybe 30, 35 years ago that I did a major study on the prison system of North Carolina as it relates to sentencing and equity of sentencing, and found in Sampson County, documented that an African American was more apt to serve time or time and a half or twice the time as a white counterpart for the same crime in that county. Justice should be blind and colorblind, but when you're dealing with a human factor, a judge, they also can bring biases to the decisions that they will ultimately make as relates to the person standing in front of them. And this is not an indictment, but this is just, I think, something that's critical. The other thing that I want to say, before I go too far, and I have a whole lot, but I don't have a whole lot. The other thing that I want to say in that whole culture is the importance of voting. How does one become a Supreme Court justice? He's recommended by the president, and the president will recommend his or her nominee to whom?
Congress.
Congress will ultimately vote yea or nay on that recommendation. Am I correct?
That's correct.
How does one become a congressperson? Someone voted for them to be a congressperson. So every judge, Judge Archie was elected. She had to run for office. Judges are elected. So when one dares not say, this election have anything to do with that, it has everything to do with you, with the judicial system. I heard someone make a statement this week that in a particular city, 45,000 African Americans didn't vote. And they didn't vote because they didn't like either candidate. And quote, Democrats and Republicans don't mean us any good. Listen to what you just said. You have really voted against yourself when you did not vote. Because if they had voted, it would have been a difference in that state election. And they tell us that North Carolina was targeted. And let me get to your notes, because y'all get to your notes. We're talking about the Bible, right? Judge Archie, you went over this, but y'all ought to know that I don't always stick to my written script. I like to say the Spirit spoke to me, and I said what I said. What I've written in red for us, and I want us to keep this clear, and I'm speaking loudly to my millennials. Stay in the struggle and stay with the church. I think we're making a rather tactical error currently with the millennials pulling away from the church and seeking to do this on their own in absentia to the strongest base that they have in the community. The strongest political base you have, we have, is the Christian church. And I want you to keep working with me. And millennials, I need y'all to work with me and talk to me. But we need to stay in this struggle together and not be divided with this issue of millennials and those of you who were born before 1954. Nobody raise your hand when you raise that question. 1954. But what I wrote in red was stay in the struggle. Stay with the church. We can do more together than we can do separately. I want to read a couple of passages. Y'all all right?
Yes.
Okay. We don't have any refreshments. Reverend Williams, we need to look at your budget. I want to read of a passage because hatred is not new. It is as old as Cain and Abel. And it has always had overt actions that were demonstrated with malicious intent. I'm learning these words from Judge Arthur, so don't ask me what that means. With a motive to harm. Cain intended to hurt Abel when he walked him in the garden. Premeditated. Can't prove that. All I know is Abel is dead. And his blood is crying out to God. And God asked Cain, where was his brother? And rather than owning up his crime, he raised the question, am I responsible for those people? Are you listening?
Yes.
The Gospel of St. John, chapter 15, uses this word, hate, verses 18 and 25b. I'm reading from the Message Bible. And our Lord is talking from the penmanship of John. And then pick up in the 18th verse. Don't worry, no sermon. You don't have to worry. Don't get uneasy. If you find the godless world is hating you, remember it got its start hating me. If you lived on the world's terms, the world would love you as one of its own. But since I picked you to live on God's terms and no longer on the world's terms, the world is going to hate you. When that happens, remember this: servants don't get better treatment than their masters. If they beat on me, they will certainly beat on you. If they did what I told them, they would do what you tell them. They're going to do all these things to you because of the way they treated me, because they don't know the one who sent me. If I hadn't come and told them all these things in plain language, it wouldn't be so bad. But as it is, they have no excuse. Hate me, hate my Father. It's all the same. Hate me, Jesus. Hate God. It's all the same. If you notice, two other references. Psalm 35:19 and Psalm 64:9. There is this reference in the Psalter, and Jesus referred as well. They hated me without cause. That harks back to this issue of motive and intent. They hated me for no apparent reason. This without cause is the sticker for me. By definition, I understand the word hate, by definition. I struggle to understand hating without cause. Is there ever a justifiable cause to hate someone? I want y'all to just think with me. Don't expect answers, and please don't look at me as having it all right. I don't. I still struggle with some of this. Yeah. And if you ever see me downtown for some of this, just say I didn't have any malicious intent. Amen. But that's the difference between a felony and a misdemeanor. I want days, not months. And you are my witnesses of these things. Without cause. Functionality for no apparent reason. Yet one has been created out of greed, especially as it pertains to Negroes, without cause. Cause. A person, thing, fact, or condition that brings about an effect, or that proceed, or that produces or calls forth a resultant action. Cause. A thing, fact, a condition that brings about an effect. Burning a cross. Cursing and swearing in 60 yards of a school or a church. Shooting a shotgun at another person of the same ethnic background. Punching somebody. But you didn't mean to punch him that hard. You just meant to get their attention. Cause, resulting. When is one responsible, not only legally, but morally, for hate? Hate. Intense hostility. Towards another. How are we going to do? Ministry, politics, in a world where there is hate. And again, it did not start with Jim Crow. It goes way back. Cain and Abel. Question for you. What were people of color called before they were called Negroes? Us all together when we were brought to these shores and used as chattel labor. I quote our second president, John Adams, and he said these words, "I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just and that his justice cannot sleep forever." Written right at the end of the 18th century in his first, while he was president, because he only had one term, lost to Jefferson in his second term. Hate. So how do you deal with this population that has been brought to these shores for labor, not as indentured servants? And George Washington was one of the major proponents in this continental United States, one of the big wigs in the Masonic Order, sheepskin and all. Believer in God, that saw the need to bring, during that time, Germans, Swiss, Danish, Italians, to America, mainly Germans and Swiss, as indentured servants. Because his argument was, that's why I argue ignorance in economics are the driving modus operandi in hatred in this country still. That black persons didn't enhance the business aspect of America. And they needed poor whites who were landless and could not vote. Are you listening? To become buyers of goods because slaves were chattel and were not buyers and producers. So how do you handle that, Cliff Jones? It became, first of all, to support this economic system in America. You had to take a people and make that people, that chattel labor, a non-people. So we start with the founding fathers and that Constitution, July 4th, 1776. In its adoption, excluded Indians and three-fifths. Because God did not make us equal. He made us, and used scripture, with ignorance, intelligent men who were ignorant, but governed by an economic system to support slavery in America. So they started, first of all, in this issue. It wasn't hatred, because you can't hate a thing. And people of color were not people. You were things, like a chicken, like a hog, like a mule, like a dog, like a gnat, like a fly. So therefore, it wasn't hate towards you because you were not a human being. It started with the dehumanization. And that's why images are so important. It was no accident that most of the images, still in many places in Africa and on the continent, and I shudder at it still, where all of the images of God were Italian. Picasso, Rembrandt. Strong Italian features. So God created in their image, the Bible says, man, female were created in the image of God. So what was the image of God in the 18th, 19th century? When you would draw the image of God, if I am Italian or British or Swiss or German, the only image I have of God is an image of myself. So it is no accident when you see all of these King James Bibles that all of the colors were white. Because we understood, preacher included growing up, God was white. That's all we ever saw. That's all they ever pushed. And with the denigration of color, black, that was the other thing we'd fight about too. I'm sorry. The other dark sheep. Don't talk about my mother, and don't talk about my color or my big nose and big lips. If you did any two of those, it was on with malicious intent. You throw a rock. Those little boys that couldn't fight, they'd outrun you. You'd pick up rocks. Some of the little boys could chunk a rock down the road. I'm sorry how I drifted there. And it comes back to what Jesus said. In this world, and he was referring to Christians and non-Christians, that we could live in a world where persons hated, in this first century, other persons just because of their religion. It was not the established religion, but a sect. I'm still old enough to remember that in the South, anything other than Baptist was suspect. Yeah. Jews were not accepted. If to read some of your Klan literature, and Catholics, and of course, Negroes. Had a very hard time in the South. So we come back to Jesus says, in this world, you will be and live and have to function in a world that can hate you, one, just because of your religious persuasion. Because you're a Christian. Now, Christians who were hated and despised in the first century, now that we are in these continental United States of America, are using the same religion that persecuted us to persecute and justify the institution of slavery. You do know that a number of the Brits came over here seeking religious freedom and oppression from the government and the Anglican Church. So now they take that same faith, that same Bible. Some of you know, and I've said for years, I've read a lot of the Ku Klux Klan literature. You may want to Google Kloran, K-L-O-R-A-N, Kloran, 1916. That was the religious document for the establishment of the Ku Klux Klan. You may want to Google that. Google. Not right now, please. Show me a little respect. And they based their doctrine on race entitlements, and they had all the trappings of religion. They used the Holy Bible. They used white sheets. White is supposed to be a color of what?
Purity.
A cross. They burned a cross. They burned a cross. The symbol for the Christian faith. All of these are religious symbols in this world that have legal ramifications. And that's why I argue that we must participate in the political process so that we not only have Democrats and or Republicans, but people of faith, the Christian faith, I would argue. I don't want to say that, though. I don't want to say that. Because you still have persons in the Christian faith that are still pushing racism. Now, it's just a little more sophisticated. They still have issues with women. Yes. Now, and gender. Now, marriage. Now. And they do it under the guise of the scripture. The Southern Poverty Law Center put out a four-part series on hate in God's name, on Hate Watch, September 2017. And it struck me because it coined this title, Hate in God's Name. And when you put some of this stuff together, you struggle with it. How do you hate in God's name? You can do that when you subjugate God to your culture. So God becomes a cultural God, the dominant culture, the culture that dominates the economy. those church-going rascals that separate the practice of business from the practice of faith. My favorite quotations, is Frederick Douglass. I still remember in his autobiography, and he was talking about his master and how cruel he was. And Frederick Douglass said one Sunday, my master got religion. Mm-hmm. and he came home after coming from church, strung up, a slave, opened his Bible and read. The Bible says, he that knoweth his master's will and doeth it not shall be beat with many stripes. And he said, with the Bible in one hand and the whip in the other, this master whooped this slave until blood ran down their ankles. How do we do that? How do you do that? How do you hate me just because of my gender or my sexual persuasion? My geographical location. The Civil War still isn't over. How do you do that? They put out this 4-part series on hate in God's name. It's time for me to stop. Tell me, don't be polite. Just tell me you're going to talk about it. Got this watch on, and I'm still learning. Oh, there it is. It's 4:28. Give me about 3 minutes, then I'll stop. Oh, you finally stood up, bro. So they tried to be polite all they wanted, but you, a little gold would go better with that black than that red. You stood up. Said there were three things that were core. Hate in God's name. How religious groups use religion to radicalize thought. One, human interpretation. Comes back to the Bible. Rightly dividing the word of truth. And cultures have looked at the Bible through their culture. They found what they needed to document, to do what they wanted to do, and ignored the rest. They dehumanized persons of other cultures and made them subhuman so that they didn't treat them as they would other human beings. They used the Bible to denigrate women and people of color, using the same Bible. Don't throw the Bible away because of a cultural bias. God's word is in here. And that's why Paul said you must rightly divide the word of truth. Understanding its cultural framework then, and understanding our cultural framework now. Said hate groups will use the Bible. Ku Klux Klanners are deeply religious people. So are the Pharisees. So were the Sadducees. And they crucified Jesus. All in the name of religion and God. Two, cultural influence. You can't ignore cultural influence as it relates to hate crimes. This whole issue of classism. And racism. Pick your isms. Cultural influence. I asked this one Sunday, I'll ask it again. What were Americans called before they were called Americans? Colonists. distinct ethnic backgrounds. I grew up in the North, as many of you know, and I still remember that there were distinctions between the Irish, Italians, those of British influence, the Scot-Irish, the Danish. I still remember the issue when the Puerto Ricans were brought here to work the fields and have permits. But I remember those distinctions within, quote, the white community, the Jews. When did they all become white? And this is not an indictment against all, because one of the persons who was most responsible for me getting out of high school and going to college was Mr. Zardes. He could have kicked me out of school in my sophomore junior year, but he gave me another chance. He took me to college. And I'm indebted to him to my grave. Cultural influence. The third is historical context. And I stop with this because we need to have some questions and we got an assignment. Historical context. You've got to know your history. And I want to argue that. You can't ignore, and I hear persons say, I don't know nothing about slavery and Jim Crow and all that stuff is past. It is not. It's just a new form. And that's why I argue about debt management. As long as you are head over heels in debt, you are a tenant farmer. You are a sharecropper. As long as you don't own something, you're a slave. Manage your debt. I close with this one. According to Frederick Clarkson, a senior fellow at Political Research, Avocation, he uses the word dominionism. And he says, dominionism is the theocratic idea that regardless of theological camp, means, or timetable, God has called conservative Christians to exercise dominion over society by taking control of political and cultural institutions. Don't play that one cheap. Political, this conservative right, they're going to the polls in unprecedented numbers. And it is no accident that this president is not thinking about legislation where preachers can actively politic. Black preachers used to do that years ago until they threatened our 501 status. Y'all know that. But now he's talking about that because that is what they would have us to do. They would to do. Because they know that if they can control the political system, y'all, please don't play that cheap. And that's why I talk as strongly as I do from the pulpit about voting. If they can control the political system, they have every say-so in every judge in this country, from local to Supreme Court. They set the laws of the land. Well, that's enough. So what are you going to do with hate? We have an assignment, and we have some questions, and when Judge Arkey and I were talking, come on, Judge, and just push me out of the way. But I may need you one day in court, so... We had on, I think, three takeaways. We each did three. And we want you, and from what you have heard, what are some takeaways? Not necessarily answers, and maybe answers, but what are some things that you take away from this to deal with hatred? And try to impress, don't be naive. It is here. Some of it is with malicious intent to harm, verbally and physically, to abuse and malign. It is there. And if you are wealthy enough, Judge don't want me to say that, and you have namesake enough, you can do some horrible things in the state of North Carolina and not serve a day. Or you can be accused by a state trooper on the highway and end up in handcuffs and in jail and have to put up bail when you've done nothing. Takeaways. Judge, I'm finished. Well, I stop. I yield. What do you want to do first? Questions?
Yes, we're going to take some questions.
Okay.
Now, if you have a question, Brother Terrence Hunter and Sister Rosemary Lawrence, I'm sorry, Sister Petunia is taking questions. So if you have any questions, please write them down and hand them to me. I'm handing them to them, and I will read some. So we received some already. And this first question is for Judge Archie. On the penalty enhancement source, words are used like cruel and heinous. How much room does this leave for error or subjectivity if not properly defined? One part of the question, and the second part of the question, what if the standards and consequences, expectations for judges practicing bias.
Okay, so let me take the first part of the question first. I mentioned very briefly pattern jury instructions. We have them in North Carolina. They are not available everywhere, but we have a committee of judges that have worked tirelessly over the last probably 30 years or so in developing what we tell jurors, so that we are telling them the same thing, and so that you have the opportunity for less and less bias to creep its way in. Because before those patterns, judges were telling jurors what they wanted them to hear, what they wanted them to know. But now we're all singing from the same sheet of music. And so the opportunity for bias is not as great as it used to be, I would say. But there is still opportunity. Because I, as a judge, impose a sentence, but a jury develops the verdict. And the verdict is developed by 12 citizens drawn from the community who look just like you. And 12 minds will agree on whether there is sufficient evidence to convict or not convict. I don't control that process. I provide the jury with some instructions, a framework that they are to use in guiding their deliberations. But ultimately, 12 citizens make the decision, and they bring with them whatever experiences they have had to that jury room and to that deliberative process. So there is still opportunity for bias in the process. What was the second half of the question?
So I believe you addressed the first half about what are the standards, consequences, and expectations for judges practicing bias. The first one was how much room on the penalty enhancement source, words are used like cruel and heinous. And how much room does this leave for error and subjectivity if not properly defined?
So what judges regularly do is go through training, and it has gotten more aggressive in recent years, about how to identify our own bias and how to manage that bias. Part of it, I think, is that if you're not careful, if you don't know that you have a bias, you're just operating in automatic pilot mode. And half the battle is recognizing when the bias is starting to bubble up. And we all have it. Just because I'm a black woman doesn't mean I'm not biased in some regard. But I have to realize when that's starting to bubble up and pump the brakes. Some of the best advice I have gotten from senior judges is do not act out of anger. Step off the bench, take a moment, continue the case and come back, but don't let your bias control you. But again, the first step is recognizing when that's happening.
Thank you. And Reverend Jones, this next question is to you, kind of staying with the theme of bias. So you spoke on the bias of the judge during your piece. How much more damaging are the biases of the church?
How much
more damaging are the biases of the church?
How much more damaging are the biases of the church? Much more than for the judge now. Two things. One, for the first question, that's why image is so important. When you go downtown before the judge, that's not a time to demonstrate how bad you are. Image has a great deal. Don't feed into the stereotypes of what that stereotype may be. Are you ever making any sense? That's the time to find you a blue blazer or something and do what you need to do to look. Okay, that's the first part. Historically, the church has, it's still damaged and damaging that the church has been biased. Because the church too often has been guided by a culture that would determine the interpretation and the utilization of Scripture to substantiate those who are in power. And I argue that we are more apt to follow a system, a scriptural imposed capitalism, rather than a Christ-centered socialism. Make some sense out of that. Any clear, balanced reading of the New Testament, Jesus was more of a socialist than he was a capitalist. In the sense of shared wealth, they had all things in common. Not I've got mine and you get yours. Yes, we have practiced it, it's still being practiced, and we have to be more forthright and honest as a Christian church.
Thank you. So the next question, back question. So what are the different types of hate as it pertains to our faith? For instance, God hates sin and quite a few other things. Shouldn't the Christian first response to hate be to ask ourselves, is this hate rooted in the Word? Asking for the ability to discern. And asking for the ability to discern.
I think sometimes we try to be a little too sophisticated in dealing with terminology. There is a distinct difference, and I can't speak for God, in God having strong dislike for behavior practice, more so than hating the one practicing. Most of us are not sophisticated enough to hate what one does without having utmost disdain for the one doing it. And the argument is, as I understand Scripture, that that's evil. Sin or hatred is a sin. Call it what it is. It's evil. It is against God's nature. So when the Scripture speaks in terms, and I really need to exegete that more before I just talk generally about that, talks about God hating sin, that it is a disdain for God when he will watch children who are imperfect have uttermost disdain for other children because they are imperfect. And it says that God has utmost disdain for that kind of attitude and practice.
Thank you. The next question. Do you think that we should turn the other cheek?
That's a spiritual question. Well, what I can tell you in my experience is there are often in court victims who have been tremendously harmed.
Yes.
In one way or another. They have either, they themselves have been harmed or their loved ones have been harmed, and they are there to speak to the court about what they feel is an appropriate outcome in a particular case. And I am always moved by those who stand up and say, I have forgiven the person who has done this harm. Spiritually, I believe that that forgiveness is more for you than it is for that other person. But that outward expression of forgiveness is nothing short of miraculous every time I hear it, particularly in some of the more heinous situations. But I often have conversation with defendants, even in the absence of a victim who says that, or a family member who says they've forgiven him or her. I have conversations with the defendants about how important it is to forgive yourself and move beyond what Pastor was talking about. Move beyond this evil act you've done, because there is life after this conviction. And you have to start thinking about what that life looks like. And it starts with you forgiving yourself so that you can do something different tomorrow.
Hatred and evil has no respect for a Christian. An evil person will slap both cheeks. And as long as you keep turning them, they'll slap them. At some point, a good example, Reverend Williams over here, she's a Christian. I just want to demonstrate. I want someone just to go over there. I think that's an analogy in the sense that we have to be forgiving, but you don't have to be stupid. And I'm not one of those Christians there yet that I'm willing to allow evil just to keep slapping my cheeks. At some point, I've got to respond in a non-malicious way to let you know that that's not acceptable. You have to let a person know that is not acceptable. And you're not more of a Christian simply because you let people walk all over you when you call it humility. That's not humility, forgive me, that's stupidity. I think the Lord would have us to stand up for our faith, but also know that there are times that you will not always be justly treated for your stance. So you've got to learn. I was reading that Dr. King, when they bombed his house for the first time, he went out on the porch immediately because they were taking up bricks and guns and stuff. And he said, don't do that. He said, we can't win this battle with guns and bullets. Over this powerful foe, that we're going to pray. Because he knew that if they did that, that they would just slaughter them. There was a, I say this and I stop. There was a bank president that I used to argue with quite a bit here in Charlotte about the situation in South Africa. And he said, you don't understand, because I had never been to South Africa. He said, the Afrikaners there will wipe them out. I said, what do you mean wipe them out? He said, you're talking about persons still fighting with shields and spears and rocks. He said, they've got tanks and armor. Said, I've been there, and the Afrikaners will wipe them out. Once I went to South Africa more than once and moved around and saw the attitudes, he was right. To try to fight them on their terms, they would have wiped them out with no conscience, as they did over 4,000 African Americans in this country between the years of 1870 and 1950 in lynching over 400 black people in this country. With no conscience. So you've got to know when to fight, and you've got to know who to fight, and you need to know when you have to turn the other cheek until you're in a better position where you don't have to do it. Grandma turned the other cheek because grandma, that was the only job she could get. It was the best job in the city, and she had her children and grandchildren were depending on her, bringing that $35 a week home and the leftovers. That's why she turned the other cheek. Uncle Bill, let them call him Boy and Uncle, because there was no other word. work in the city, and if he lost that job, there was no place for him to go. That's why Uncle Bill turned the other cheek.
Judge Archie, I believe this question is for you. What's the impact of social media on determining intent and motivation?
It's growing. So, as I mentioned, intent, motive, often not provable by direct evidence. It must ordinarily be proved from circumstances from which it may be inferred. I can say that in my sleep. Because I talk to jurors about that all the time. And social media will often add some insight into what people are thinking. You would be surprised at how much people put on social media these days. And it is becoming more and more of an investigative tool as the police attempt to build a case against suspects. And people will put out there in full photographic color what they think and feel, whether that's in the display of a shirt or, you know, captions to photographs, comments on photographs. And I would say probably, two or three times a week, I am presented with search warrants to go look at Facebook and go look at Twitter accounts and go through phone and text messages because they are looking for what you have said, what you have done about this person, around this person, to this person, so that can be used against an individual. So social media is, I can only imagine, is going to continue to be relevant, more and more relevant as time goes on, and that social media footprint builds over time.
Last question, okay. So, unfortunately, we only have time for one more question. So, how does the new Jim Crow connect with this presentation?
I understand the term, but I argue there was never an ending of the old Jim Crow. Jim Crow has never died. It's just the old Jim Crow with 21st century language and actions. The systemic, the system, hatred and evil has been there. It has never died, but it went underground during the latter part of the 60s and probably through January 2015. But as of February 1, 2016 through 2016 and all of 17 and the beginning of 2018, it has been resurrected in bold captions in all sectors of our society. Through our commentators on Fox News. Well, the whole thing. I don't think it was ever. I understand, and I think it's wonderful for the caption and tremendous by God in terms of the new Jim Crow. But my argument is it's not new. When you know your history and know of your history, it's not new. It's just old. In a new or different uniform.
Thank you.
Now we'll have Sister Rosemary.
No. We got three takeaways.
We don't have Sister Rosemary. We have three takeaways.
Judge?
One of my takeaways, especially from a legal context, is that yes, hate can motivate bad action, among a number of other motivations. But hate is certainly one of them and certainly very real. address hate, punish hate, manage hate. We cannot eliminate hate. Only people can do that. That's a matter of the heart. And that in the context of the court system, the courts can be used as both a sword and a shield. They can be used to advance interests that you are passionate about, but the court can also be used as a hammer that comes down pretty hard on some people. So it can be both protector and punisher at the same time.
Takeaways. As believers in Christ, we are conquerors, though victimized. Live with confidence. Takeaway, live with confidence in a world where hatred is real. Two, balance the outward and sometimes hateful fractions with inward spiritual peace. Balance that that's outside of you and that that's inside of you. So I argue here for meditation and prayer. Balance that that's outside of you that you don't like but can't control, that you have to live with. Balance that with your inward spiritual peace. Three, participate in the political process through advocacy and voting. Participate in the political process through advocacy and voting. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Please give Judge Austin and
two political forums, one, if there is a primary, today, you can do that right at this table. We have the information there. It's a very quick process. It takes less than 5 minutes to do that. So we're very happy to help you with that. Finally, please go to the website for any updates. And the website is www.friendshipcharlotte.org. And watch your bulletins. Now we will have our closing prayer by Miss Danielle Jackson. Miss Jackson. Of course, thank you so much.
Good evening. If we could bow our head. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this opportunity for us to come together. Many of us are constantly struggling with the once again being at the intersection of hate in our Christian faith and our moral compass. Let us have this opportunity and use this opportunity to rewrite and correct and recalibrate our moral compass to the true north, which is to be of service, to represent ourselves, our integrity, our moral responsibility, our complexity of being a Christian and the simplicity that it is that we often, with our intellect, make it so much more complicated than it needs to be. Let us go forth and just be kind and be respectful,
yes,
and be mindful that we are all individuals. We are all collectively connected,
yes,
and that at the end of the day, we need each other as much as we need you. And so, once again, just thanking you for this opportunity for us to get together, for us to continue to learn, to grow, and to be enlightened, and hopefully exercise and bring this to the community and to the people that we touch. These things we ask and thank you for in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
And before we leave, please put the surveys in the survey box over there by the exits. Thank you. Have a great night.